all went out the window. So I came to DMU in 2006, spent quite a lot of time thinking about where to go in terms of research and what was new, what was exciting. And then I accidentally stumbled into cyber psychology through a project with our research strand of the Ministry of Defence. So they asked us or commissioned us to do a piece of work, and that is where my journey down the rabbit hole began, and it's led me to this point. So my research trajectory, the first research project was the DSDL project. That one was looking at how individuals use digital technology and also how that could actually have an impact on elements of human cognition. At the time, it was interesting for me because I was aware of some research that was around, but what the project actually showed me is that even though I thought there was lots of research looking at human cognition and the use of digital technology and the internet, actually it was fairly disparate. There wasn't actually a great deal of sort of cohesive approach to actually doing this research. So it showed me that there was limited research and understanding in the area. There was some research out there, and I started to think, well, is there a capacity to not only pull this together, but also is there a capacity to actually do more research in this area and actually try and carve out a niche within cyber psychology looking at the cognitive elements? That was all great, but then I got distracted. So whilst I was doing that original project, some other projects came along. The second projects I was involved with, major project, was looking at the systematic detection of insider threat. That was really interesting and again showed me another facet of cyber psychology that could be used not only in a more effective manner but also actually doing something. Research has to have a point. I don't do research just for the sake of, oh, here's a lovely paper, it all looks really well, it ends up on a bookshelf forever. My research is proactive. It actually gets an answer to the questions that we need answers to. Second project I was involved with, which is also linked to DSTL, the MOD, was looking at automated cyber defence. I learned a lot about random decision trees and random decision forests that I will never learn again. My role on that project was to help design the human factors component to that, so the end individual that was actually analysing data could interpret it accurately. That followed on to a third project, looking at insider threat within the business supply chain. And then more latterly, I've been involved in a large project with a large multinational organisation looking at the capacity to explore gamification in the context of cybersecurity. I did all that and then got back to thinking about the first part because obviously, you know, get a little bit distracted. So I went back to the first part of this entire journey, looking at how digital technology can impact on human cognition. So I started to build a research sort of profile, thinking about how to actually start to look at, does the use of digital technology actually impact on basic elements of human cognition? And I thought the best place to start was aspects of attention. So my main premise was, does the use of digital technology, or particularly addiction to digital technology, have an impact on basic elements of attention? Well, the simple answer to this is yes. In an original paper I created back in 2015, I explored the links between internet addiction, mobile phone addiction, and also something we call cognitive failures. Now, for those of you that aren't familiar with cognitive failures, it's a scale that Broadbent created back in 1982 that actually looks at aspects of our daily lives that would be classified as having some sort of cognitive element to their you know, to our mishaps. So, for example, going from one room to another and forgetting why you went into that room. And every time I say that, someone says, oh, I've done that today. Other elements include things like forgetting a person's name or just blurting out something without actually thinking about it. Your current president might have, you know, some quality of failings of his own recently. So we've got key elements there. Also, you've got this notion that these things are controlled through attentional processes, through concentration. What I found was there was a distinct correlation between internet addiction, mobile phone addiction, and cognitive failures. What we can't say from those results is there's a causative link. Obviously, there's no cause, you can't say one creates another. What we could say is that aspects of attentional control could be limited due to internet addiction or vice versa. Those people with lower attentional control could be seeking out interaction online, hence why they experience excessive use online. I also repeated this study with a smartphone addiction scale because the original scale used was solely on mobile phones. As we know, smartphones obviously have other functionality to them, and I wanted to see if there was the same correlational link. And yes, there was. Interestingly, same link was found. So here we have the first tentative steps towards exploring how aspects of digital technology, particularly the internet, mobile phones, smartphones, can actually be seen to have some sort of impact, whichever way that goes, on aspects of human cognition. So that was one of the first studies I completed, and I got distracted again. I got involved in a local project called the East Midlands Police Academic Collaboration. What the premise for this is that it's a collaborative partnership between local law enforcement, so the main forces within Leicestershire, and also the main universities in the area. Now, this is something of an unusual situation, particularly when we think about universities as a whole, because usually we're always trying to get one over on each other and trying to nick research, borrow research, and, you know, get students to come to us. But in this instance, we buried the hatchet and we got together and created this partnership. So there are five main institutions and five constituent forces. And what we did was we actually asked the forces, what are the main research questions that you have that academics could help you with? And this formed the basis of the MPAC collaboration. My role in this was to head up the serious organised crime component, which focused solely on cybercrime and cybersecurity. From a regional level, some of the higher end aspects of serious organised crimes was they were sort of omitted from the remit, things like terrorism, radicalisation. For us as a region, they are important, but they have a national portfolio, so we focused on the more local elements. One of the key things that was suggested by the police is that they wanted more intelligence on the actual susceptibility of individuals to cybercrime, and also explore how human factors within cybercrime or cybersecurity were interacting. So one of the first pieces of study, one of the first pieces of research we actually conducted was to explore how small medium enterprises, those organisations that have less than 250 people within their population, we want to explore their experiences and also their employees' experiences of cybersecurity. So we wanted to sort of engage them, try and get them involved. What this research showed us from the very start is that most of the time, small, medium enterprises really have no interest in cybersecurity whatsoever until they get attacked. So, for instance, one of the companies we went out to try and get them involved in the research was absolutely adamant. They had no time for it, had no need for it. They were only a small business. They were only about 10 people in the organisation. Essentially, they couldn't get us out of the building quick enough. 3 months later, they got attacked by ransomware. The ransomware was action through someone clicking on a spam email. I think it was a help desk email that they clicked on. The company lost around about £30,000 within the space of 2 days. Within 2 hours, they not only contacted me, but also three of the forces within the region to see if we could help. To which I explained that they needed to contact our national agency, Action Fraud. And I didn't really want to tell them, I told you so, but I told them so. And we actually implemented some measures to try and help them change the behaviour of their employees, looked at the behaviours. We didn't go down the route of trying to find out who actually actioned the email. We knew it was, but we found that actually trying to go down a punitive route and actually, you know, making people feel, you know, like they've been idiots doesn't work with cyber security and cyber crime. Actually pointing at the errors and trying to give them a sense of self-efficacy works a lot better. So that was one of the big experiences of that small study. What came out of this study, quite interestingly, is this notion that within business, or within businesses, employees have this sense of risk homeostasis theory or risk compensation theory. So individuals, when they're in employment, because they are sat behind a computer that's also sat behind a company firewall, which has antivirus on, which has numerous amounts of protection on, they think, great, okay, that means I can take more risks, so I'm protected. The system itself will protect me. So if I'm at work and I want to open this email attachment, I'm not quite sure where it came from, it's fine because IT will pick up the pieces after we've been breached. This seems to be coming through quite a lot in the research, looking at individual experiences, particularly employees within an organisation. There were some interesting findings that came out of not only this research, but follow-on research. And I shall regale you with some of the nightmare statistics that I obtained. So, these are components to attitudes to cybersecurity. 98% of those people questioned in that survey believed it's the responsibility of management, in the capital letters, to protect the company from cybercrime. Not the individual, I don't care. It's management. It's those people that sit upstairs in those wonderful little offices, their responsibility. This is quite interesting because it shows that individuals are offloading their responsibility for cybersecurity. 58%, over half, had no idea how to protect the company from cybercrime. This was also mapped onto the 55% that didn't think they had the right skills. What skills they think they need to protect the company from cybercrime is something that we still need to do more research on. 80% of those asserted that they thought cybercriminals were more advanced than those that were preventing attacks. This comes through a lot in the research that I've been doing, that individuals who sit within organisations still have this notion, maybe it's right, maybe it's wrong, that those people that are committing these cybercrime attacks are infinitely more sophisticated, more advanced, have more money to throw at these types of activities than those people that are, you know, trying to protect us. 84% believe that more could be communicated to them about the risks of cybercrime to the organisation. This is quite interesting because we've seen a resurgence in the literature looking at how best to deal with training individuals in aspects of good information security. Most of the time, people who get emails will simply delete the email. Those that headed up read this important information about cybersecurity usually will probably get deleted within the first 3 seconds if it mailbox. What we find more effective, particularly through the literature, is targeting people with focus group campaigns, getting them in to talk about aspects of cybersecurity, and also getting people, guest speakers, to go in to talk about the risks of poor information security. Now, this might not seem like a very cost-effective approach, but it can be done on a wide scale. And also, the effectiveness is a lot more evident in comparison to simple emails about, oh, look out for these phishing attacks. Most of the time, those emails that send out actually look like phishing attacks themselves. So you can understand the confusion that employees have. 48% didn't feel confident in the answer to detect a cyber attack, and 44% wouldn't know where to report it. That's quite important. Those people that are potentially victims or could be victims of a cyber attack within the organisation have no idea where to report this information to. Where do they go? Who do they send this email to? What do I do with it? Do I forward it on with the, you know, the potential to spread a virus or another issue around the system? The smaller amount, 32%, said it was not their responsibility to report cybercrime within the company. Again, this maps onto those previous figures. So there's 32% of people theoretically sat in an organisation going, well, we've had a ransomware attack, I'm not going to do anything about it, I'm just going to sit here and look at that screen and wait for those files to be deleted. So we've got quite an interesting confluence of attitudes going on within cybersecurity. In the second part of the study, we actually asked for people to tell us about their actual risky behaviours that they were conducting in the context of cybersecurity. If you have a squeamish disposition and you're easily shocked by poor information security behaviours, I suggest you look away now, because some of these headlines are really, really bad. So, I know some of these figures might seem fairly insignificant, but you only need one person to do one of these things to put the organisation at jeopardy. So 33% of individuals admitted to using their own USB, unencrypted, to transfer work data onto. We all know that lots of people do lots of things they maybe shouldn't do at home with USB sticks, and then coming to work with stuff that shouldn't be on USB sticks and then plug into their computers. For example, maybe they've downloaded copyrighted material, films from nefarious websites. A lot of those websites will actually have malicious software installed and embedded on them. So potentially, you've got 33% of your employees coming to work with a ticking time bomb in their pocket that they're happily sticking into your computers. 44% relied on a friend or colleague to provide them with advice on cybersecurity. Interestingly, when we actually asked one of the SMEs about this, one of the managers told me, in well, not in confidence because I'm telling you guys now, but actually told me that his 14-year-old son was his cybersecurity expert. I kid you not. Essentially, he was the expert because he knew computers and he was cheap. I will end that bit there. 67% of people use free to access public Wi-Fi. Now, there is some kind of contention about whether this could actually put someone at risk. And we have seen some stories about free to access public Wi-Fi being shadowed, being snooped. So there are elements here where people could access information on personal computers, personal data. I know there are some instances where people have been sort of, that they've had aspects scanned on their computer, and you can create free to access public Wi-Fi hotspots fairly easily with not a lot of money. So people don't actually see that as being a risk in a lot of cases. 47% online storage systems used to exchange personal information. Yet again, we're not going to get down the route of whether certain storage systems online are better than others, but if you are storing information online, you need to make sure that that information is in the right place and cannot be used to jeopardise your position within that organisation. The exclamation mark for the next one was me going, oh my giddy aunt, this isn't very good. 69% use the same password for multiple websites. I think there's a statistic floating around that says that we have to remember around about 8 or 9 different passwords for systems within the workplace. It's not unusual to find individuals having to use the same password for multiple websites, because from a cognition point of view, remembering a password that has a capital, has a different type of letter, has a Greek letter, you have to sit on your head, type it into the computer, and then turn around 3 times, and whatever you have to do, these issues pose a lot of problems for the normal average user within daily life. They can't remember all this information. Hence why they go off to try and record all their passwords on a piece of paper that sits next to their computer. And that has happened. 40% create basic passwords. Again, we're back to the notion that individuals suffer from mental overload. They might put the wrong password into the wrong system. So, you know, what's easy for me to remember? I know my name and 123. That'll work. No one will ever guess that one. The last one is 27% shared passwords with friends and colleagues. In some institutions, this is freely acceptable. But from the perspective of an insider threat, it's still very risky. And also, how do you make sure that the person you've just given your password to is trustworthy and will not then go off and write it down everywhere they know where to put it? But also, some friends and colleagues don't always stay your friends and colleagues. There is a situation that always brews up in an institution where someone might have a falling out over a certain aspect of their life, potentially linked to disgruntlement at work. That gives them a weapon to later use. And if they've got your login details and they log onto the computer using your details and then do something very naughty, you're going to get the blame for it, not them. So these are some of the key aspects to this piece of research that, number one, scared the living hell out of me, but number two, showed that in terms of risky online behaviours, the messages about information security really aren't getting through. Lots of people are still doing lots of things that we would think, oh, surely in this day and age, particularly with this one, creating basic passwords, surely in this day and age, we should be getting past this point. But no, employees still have this barrier against effective cybersecurity, and also have this reticence to engage in active information security. So, what is the most destructive element in the context of cybersecurity? My premise is that you can have the most sophisticated, most expensive, spend £1 million on cybersecurity infrastructure, have biometrics, etc., etc. All it needs is Joe Bloggs to come in on a Monday morning and go, you know what, I don't want to go through that virus anti-protection thing again. I'm just going to turn it off today, or I'll bring my own computer in, get on the network, and I'll access that website myself. So within the space of 5 minutes, that individual has circumvented your million-pound cybersecurity infrastructure because they want to get online to download the next episode of Game of Thrones. It's as simple as that. And what we're seeing more and more within the information security network and also the security network itself is the understanding or the notion that mitigation techniques for security or for cybersecurity can't just solely rely on technology alone. Humans are fallible. We know that if we put something to a computer and say, add 2 + 2 together, it will always give us the same answer. But if I go to someone on a Monday morning and say, can you do this piece of work for me now? There's a whole host of things that could happen. Oh no, I don't want to do that. I'm not feeling it today. Or I haven't really got the time to do it. Or et cetera, et cetera. So humans present the unknown within any security environment. And the problem we have, not only as technical professionals, but also security professionals, and also as psychologists, and whoever else wants to get involved in this smorgasbord of nightmares, those individuals, we have to start to understand how aspects of human factors, not just personality, but also cognition, can start to impact on aspects of cybersecurity, because they do. We know they do. We've seen it happen. So we need to start to think about what is the research we need to do, and we need to be unified in doing it. At the moment, there's lots of little pockets of people doing lots of little pieces of research around the world, which is great. Everybody wants a slice of the pie. But until we actually start to present a unified approach within the context of cybersecurity and human factors, we run the risk of repeating things over and over again. So, what did I do? I decided to forget that bit, and I went back to the original premise of what I started in the first place, which is this notion of cybercognition. So cybercognition is used by me to describe two individual aspects of our use of digital technology. So in the one respect, we've got the notion that cybercognition describes the cognitive processes that we use online. So for example, there are a variety of different mechanisms that we use when we assess credibility in the online environment. Researchers have suggested that this process isn't really very different to the process we use offline, but because we're encountering more and more information, potentially through fake news, potentially through things like Twitter, Facebook, because we're encountering more information, we're deploying this type of reasoning more often. This is a heuristic-based process that we're trying to assess information based on what we know, what's happened, and what could happen. Also, the term cybercognition I've used to refer to potential for digital technology to change or alter cognitive processes. We're seeing a lot of scare stories in the media about the notion that the younger generation is, you know, increasingly harder to get engaged, have poor attentional capacity, spend less and less time interacting with, you know, real people. My argument against this is surely that's every teenager that's ever been born since the year dot, but I might be wrong. But we're getting increasing amounts of material coming through showing the aspects of social media, social networking, internet addiction is actually starting to potentially have an influence on the way in which the younger generation is interacting with digital technology. But also, it's not just the younger generation. How many of you sat there today have had a notification or a message in your pocket that's vibrated? I can't see people putting their hands up, so I'll take it as someone has, at some point during the day, and a vibration alert. What this does in the context of your attention is it distracts your attention away from what you're doing, and you are now sat there thinking, who could that be? Is it the lottery contacting me to tell me I've won £1 million? Or could it be a mundane email telling me that, you know, I've got to contact the help desk because my password's wrong and I've got to update it? These aspects have started to permeate through society. We're seeing an increasing rise in things such as nomophobia, the fear of losing your phone or not having access to your phone. We've got fear of missing out, FOMO, not MOFO, don't confuse it with MOFO, very important distinction. There's also an element of what a lot of people have started to call smombies. Smartphone zombies have arisen in today's society. Those individuals that walk around with smartphones attached to their face like this, an increased rise in accidents related to smartphone use, people stepping out in front of cars, people walking off piers, I've not made that up, people have actually walked off cliffs whilst using smartphones. Unfortunately, the notion of death by selfie has also raised its ugly head in the past years. Don't laugh, that's not right. But yeah, it has raised its ugly head. More and more people are now trying to get more extreme selfies to actually show that they can do it. So we get people climbing skyscrapers, you know, doing death-defying leaps to try and get the best selfie ever. This is a sign of the times. We're not saying it's a moral panic. I'm not trying to say it's a moral panic. What we're trying to say is that it's happening. We need to understand why it's happening. We need to understand the risks of this escalating. And also, we need to understand, how do we mitigate the threat? If there's a threat there, how do we stop people becoming a victim of potential death by selfie? I decided there was enough research out there for me to sit down and write a book, so I wrote a book. I wrote the book as a textbook because that's what the publishers wanted, but I added in my own inevitable humour, unfortunately, and also I wrote it so that anybody could go pick it up off a shelf and read it. It introduces the concept of cyber psychology from the perspective of John Sula's work and from the original work looking at cyberspace, but also then introduces cognitive psychology and gives a background on cognitive psychology and the key components that are discussed throughout the book. And I really wanted to try and make sure that it wasn't a very boring, static textbook that would just sit on someone's shelf. I wanted people to use it to go off and do more research or to actually think, oh yeah, well actually, this is important. We need to start to think about this in real terms. So, building on my current work, what am I doing now? So, I discussed the fact that I'm embedded with our local digital media investigators who are based within Leicestershire. They're a good bunch, they make good tea, they always have cakes, always a bonus, but more importantly, they're always looking for help and research. Law enforcement, particularly their local police force and police force in general, are always looking for ways to get academia involved in research. And I'm more than happy to get involved with them because, as I said before, my research always has an impact. I always make sure there's a so what element to it. So if I can go in, help them design a piece of research, get some good data, yes, I might get a paper out of it, but more importantly, we get actionable intelligence that helps them understand what's going on within an organization. So for example, one of the pieces of work they asked me to do was do focus groups with frontline staff. So we actually explored frontline staff experience of cybercrime and cybersecurity. That was really interesting. The results for that we're trying to analyse at the moment, but interestingly, the police force, particularly in this country, hate Facebook. They really wish Facebook would die. Because more and more, they're getting people that are ringing them up or sending them emails saying, someone's defriended me on Facebook. This is a cybercrime. I need your help. Unfortunately for the police, that's not just one example. There are hundreds of examples of people contacting them saying, oh, one of my friends has said something bad about me on Facebook. I'm really upset. Can you arrest them? I'm not lying. People have actually contacted the police and actually rung our emergency number to ask people to help them. So in terms of Facebook, we've got this proliferation that obviously there should be more responsibility on some of these host organisations. We're also moving on to look at exploring attitudes and behaviours of younger adults, particularly under the age of 18, in terms of their understanding of cybercrime and cybersecurity. At the moment, there is almost a blank space below the age of 18 where we're either too scared to find out what's going on, or it's actually getting to tap into the language that the children are using to understand what they understand about cybercrime and cybersecurity. This work has two fundamental outputs. Number one, if we can understand the language that children are using to describe aspects of cybercrime, surely we are better enabled to be able to communicate with them what they should and shouldn't be doing. Using their language is more effective than hoity-toity government officials sitting there going, yes, you are going to be a victim of ransomware or phishing attacks. Most of the kids these days will have no idea what we're talking about. So by understanding the language they're using, we can more effectively communicate the risks to them. Similarly, we know that a lot of children who come from marginalised or diverse multicultural backgrounds, those that might be socially excluded, also suffer some lack of knowledge within the area of cybersecurity. To recount a piece of information that I was party to because I was involved in a local charity and some of the work they were doing, we sent out a questionnaire, or they sent out a questionnaire to a group of between 10 and 16 year olds who were socially excluded, had poor family backgrounds, a lot of them had single parent families. They asked them a variety of questions. Some of those involved, have you been approached by a stranger online? Have you ever been asked to give explicit material out online? Have you ever sent pictures of yourself online? In the analysis of the data, the charity found that two of the girls that were involved in the study had been approached by ISIS to become recruits, to go over to Syria and to become part of sort of the support service for ISIS, do medical care, cooking meals. These were children aged around about 12 to 13. The perpetrators of the information were offering things like smartphones, laptops, money, to coerce the children into actually engaging in these activities. More worryingly is that two of the girls were actually engaged in two-way conversations with these people and didn't actually see the risks that were being involved. These conversations were happening completely outside the knowledge of anybody else within their friendship sphere, and also the adults within their lives knew nothing about this. So needless to say, that was pursued at a higher level than I got involved with, and we are safe in the knowledge that those two young adults are safe and not now being communicated. But this shows a very, very scary underlying trend that's going on within cyberspace. It might not just be terrorist groups that are doing this. We know that things like paedophilia goes on. We've got, child sexual exploitation. But until we know the actual sort of ramifications, the actual scope of what's going on within this younger generation, we won't know how best to tackle it. So I think this piece of work is a really important piece of work. And I know myself and Scott are talking about doing something collaboratively to try and get this on the books within the local region over there as well. And I think it's a really important bit of work. Wider work I've been involved with, just completed a piece of research with Catherine Parsons, who's based over in the Australian Ministry of Defence. We examined the link between cyberloafing. For those that don't know what cyberloafing is an activity where you essentially use work-based equipment or work-based internet access for personal purposes. So, for example, sending a personal email, maybe going online at lunchtime to look at the news, that's still classified as cyberloafing. And also, more seriously, maybe going online to look at pornography within work time or doing online gambling. So we examine the link between cyberloafing, internet addiction, and information security awareness. That paper's been submitted for review. It's still in review. And the results for that are really interesting. To give abridged versions of it, essentially, cyberloafing and internet addiction are both very good predictors of information security awareness. The prevalence of cyberloafing in the organisations we looked at, I sampled 340 participants for this. The cyberloafing that's going on is pretty widespread. Most people go on the basis that it's a social norm. Someone else does it, I can do it, it's fine. But what people don't understand is that by actually engaging in cyberloafing, they might be opening up the organisation not only to potential slower network service, but also there might be issues with people opening up that network for attack. So if you're downloading something on a work computer that you shouldn't be, then there might be potential for that to creep in and do something naughty. Also, we've done another focus group. This was done by a student last year, which we're currently writing up, that actually looks at the use of iPad technology within 8 to 9 year olds. This was particularly targeted at 8 to 9 year olds because this is one of the groups we don't know a lot about. And also, it targeted home use. We know people are using it in education, but we wanted to try and target it more towards home use. All I can say is, 8 to 9 year olds, when they want to use their iPads, are the sneakiest people on the planet. To give you an example, one of the respondents within these focus groups actually explained that he would hide his iPad in his pajamas and then go and pretend to have a bath, but whilst he was running the bath, he would be playing on his iPad in the toilet. They are really sneaky. Another child would wait for his parents to go to bed, and this was quite late at night, would wait for them to go to bed and then would sneak down to go find the iPad and then take it back upstairs and use it in bed. So we've got an element here that a lot of these younger children, particularly 8 to 9 year olds, not only are they quite subversive in the way they want to use iPads, but they're also showing very basic signs of internet or particular behavioural addiction. They talk a lot about aspects of withdrawal. They talk a lot about mood modification in the context of using their iPads. But also, there's a notion that they are very much dependent on this technology. A lot of them reported actually sitting and watching the iPads recharge so that they could use them. For me, that's almost as interesting as watching a washing machine go around. But for these kids, it's part of their daily life. They really want to engage in that particular activity. So much so, they will sit there and watch that iPad recharge. So that gives you an idea of some of the work I'm involved with at the moment. I think that's what I wanted to talk about today. I am freely available if people want to contact me. There's also the book there. You can probably find it in the local bookshop if they actually exist anymore. More likely, it's probably a trip online to Amazon. But thank you for having me. Any questions?
there's any questions, I'll bring the microphone up to you guys. Any questions? I think you're off the hook, Lee.
No, I like that.
We've got one question, you're not off the hook, hold on.
Good afternoon to you.
Hiya.
Putting together both your talk and Melanie's talk before, I don't know if you had a chance to speak to that. Do you think internet therapy would enable or reinforce an addictive personality?
Oh, that's an interesting one. I'm not sure. I think it might be an element of sort of over egging the pudding, if I can use a vernacular term. I know at the moment a lot of people are going down this notion of digital detox and, you know, the sudden shock of taking people offline to make sure that they can readjust to an environment without, you know, internet access. But I think what we've got to remember is that when we use the term internet addiction, it's an umbrella term that could actually be disguising lots of other potential addictions. Mark Griffiths talks about this quite a lot, and he suggests that internet addiction might be disguising things such as gambling addiction or addiction to online pornography. So whether using the internet as a therapeutic intervention to get away from internet addiction, I'm not sure. I will have to hold my hands up and say that that one's probably beyond me at the moment.
Other question?
Scott, my name is Ralph Alpha, retired from the DOD. You use the term internet addiction throughout your presentation. Could you define it a little more in a little more detail? I mean, you talked about initially on the slides about, you know, every teenager, you know, pretty much has this addiction.
I think we have to be careful because I don't think every teenager has internet addiction. I think what we're seeing is that there are elements of an addictive complex going into teenagers. So in terms of internet addiction is typified by a pervasive, a compulsive urge to use the internet or to access the internet. Part of that process is that once the individual is withdrawn from that situation, they actually experience symptoms that are akin to sort of a drug relapse or not being able to access drugs. So we're talking about depression, low mood, a notion of where to get my next fix, where can I get access to the internet. Generally, you see a variety of elements. Mark Griffith's work, again, goes through a component of aspects of withdrawal, salience in someone's life. So the internet will have a salience. So it will be a feature of your daily life. So you will need to get online all the time. Interestingly, with the internet and searching the internet, is it actually excites parts of the brain, that normally would sort of reduce in excitation over a period of time. But the internet, or searching the internet and digital technology, actually keeps that excitation at a peak. So it provides constant stimulation. There's something new all the time. And that's part of the element of why people potentially become addicted to it, because it provides that same hit every time they go online.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much, Lee.